Hello, and welcome to worship at West Los Angeles United Methodist Church. Thank you for joining us on this fourth Sunday after Pentecost as we celebrate God's steadfastness in the midst of change. As we begin our service, please join me in the responsive call to worship. Come, open your eyes and hearts to the love of Jesus Christ. We are grateful to be here, remembering all that Christ has done for us. Friends and family and visitors, all are welcome in this place. Those who are new to this church, those who seek, those who feel lost and alone. Wherever we are in our spiritual journey, Christ welcomes us and lights our path so that we may see the way and uplift others. Christ embraces us with transforming and forgiving love. Let us rejoice in Christ's love. Let us respond to the call to receive and be Christ's love in the world, to recognize the needs of God's creation and to reach out with compassion and loving kindness.
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my ears that I may hear voices of truth thou sendest clear. And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything false will disappear. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my ears, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my mouth and let me bear gladly the warm truth everywhere. Open my heart and let me prepare love with thy children.
Let us pray together. God of loving kindness, compassion, and peace, bring your dazzling light into our hearts and spirits, that we might see the glorious opportunities we have to be in your hands and heart and voice for justice in this world. Help us to see that following your mandate to feed the hungry, bring nourishment to those who thirst, offer clothing to those in need, visit the sick and those who are imprisoned, and welcome the stranger as acts of great privilege and joy. We praise you for the light of your Son, Jesus Christ, who boldly bids us to care for each other and become those who would bring the good news of peace for all. Amen.
Hi, kids, and welcome to worship today. My name is Jeri, and I'm a member of this church. And it's my pleasure to sometimes teach Sunday school and to do sometimes our summer programs. So it's really fun for me to join all of you here today. I'm going to start by telling you a story about when I was a little girl. So when I was a little girl in elementary school and middle school and high school, my family had to move all the time. We moved every 2 years or so. And sometimes we moved in the middle of the school year. So that was really hard, especially when I was little, because I was very, very shy. And it was hard for me to go up to kids I didn't even know and say, "Hi, my name is Jeri. Would you like to play? Or can I sit with you at lunch?" So those first few days in a new school always made me really nervous and scared. And there were times, too, when I was so scared that I wouldn't have anybody to eat lunch with, that I would just hide. I would go hide in the bathroom or in a corner somewhere where nobody could see me. And I'll tell you, sometimes I even cried. So I don't know if you've ever been a new person at school, maybe even here at church, or at a summer camp, and you just felt a little nervous because you didn't know anybody, and you didn't know if you were going to make friends. But I want to tell you that at every single school that I went to, maybe not on that first day, but certainly that first week, there would be somebody, usually another little girl, who would come up to me and say, "Hi, what's your name? Do you want to have lunch with me?" And I would be so excited, and my heart would feel so much better that I had made a friend and that someone had come to me because I was so shy and asked to be my friend. And so we would get our lunches out, and sometimes, you know what, I would even forget my lunch sometimes, but we would share, and we would maybe share a sandwich. My mom always made me bologna sandwiches. Or maybe we'd have some pretzels and potato chips. And usually some kind of healthy food, right? And something to drink. And if it was a special day, I might get a cookie or a cupcake. And so when we ate lunch together, we would laugh and talk about our favorite foods, and we would get to know each other and have a good time. And you know, some of those kids are still my friends today, almost 50 years later. So when I get a Christmas card from my friend Sandy, I can still recognize her handwriting because it's almost the same as it was when we were best friends in the fourth grade. So why am I telling you this story? I'm telling you this story because this is the kind of story that goes all the way back in time, to the time of Jesus and even before that time. A lot of times Jesus was a new person in town, or his disciples were new in town. And so in the scripture that the grown-ups are going to learn today, Jesus said, "When I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. And when I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. And when I was a stranger, you welcomed me." So I think about my friends from the fourth grade, like Sandy, or some of the other friends I made through the years, who welcomed me, the stranger, and we shared food and drink together. And they treated me as if I was like a very special person, like Jesus. And then because I've had those experiences, whenever I see somebody new, whenever I see somebody sitting by themselves, especially here at church, I go over and I say hello and welcome. And when we did have good treats, come, have something to eat and to drink. So I hope that when you go back to school, if you're doing some activities this summer, if you see some new kids coming to church, that you will welcome the stranger and say hello And like we have all in our Sunday school rooms, that you will be like Jesus and be the voice and the love that says, welcome. Let's pray together. Loving God, thank you for this time together with my church family. Help me to be loving and kind and to welcome new friends. Show me where love is needed in my family, in my church, in my school, and in my activities. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, and we'll see you again soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Hear this reading from the Gospel of Matthew 25, beginning with the 34th verse. Listen for the word of God. Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, Truly I tell you, as you did it to one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick, and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning and welcome to worship. Last Sunday, we gave thanks to God for the blessing of Reverend Gary Oba and Reverend Janet Cromwell and their time spent here at the West LA United Methodist Church before their retirement. We gathered together for their final worship and a celebration of their ministries and legacies. So this month, beginning this July, we are welcoming a new chapter at this 92-year-old West Los Angeles United Methodist Church. We look forward to welcoming our new senior pastor, Reverend Keith Inouye, to the pulpit on August 7th. But in the meantime, in this interim month of July, there will be a number of lay-led as well as special guest speakers who will be joining us. And we will be focusing on the theme set at our 2022 annual conference. So for those of you who aren't familiar with the annual conference, this is a gathering of the clergy, the lay people, the friends of the California Pacific Annual Conference who come together, usually once a year. Pandemic times have been a little bit different, but we all come together to take care of legislative matters, policy directions, special commemorations, memorials, and certainly the ordination and commissioning of new pastors. The theme this year was ending spiritual and physical hunger. And we, like every year, are invited to come back to our local congregations and to really contemplate what that is and to think about how we might address that theme in our own churches and in our own lives. So that's what we are going to be doing this July. We are blessed to have, as I mentioned, special guests, and we will continue to examine the scripture that you heard from the Gospel of Matthew. I begin today this series of sermons with a focus on recognizing spiritual and physical hunger in our midst. Our prayer of preparation today asks three questions. What do I hunger for this day? What do I thirst for this day? Who around me is in need? Perhaps as you're watching this, you missed breakfast, your stomach is growling, or you missed your morning cup of coffee, and you're feeling a little cranky and maybe sleepy, or maybe you're just parched from this summer heat. That's one kind of hunger and thirst, the physical kind that we feel in our bodies. Our stomachs may tighten or growl. We may get a headache. We may feel faint or dizzy. Our bodies need food and drink to survive. Or maybe your stomach is full and you're not thirsty in that sense, but you may be going through a tough time right now. Like me, I've had several friends who've had medical diagnoses in the last few months that are frankly pretty scary. People may be going through treatment for cancer or maybe for addiction. Or maybe you're coming up on the anniversary of when a loved one passed, a time that always brings up memories and sometimes a little sorrow as well. And I think it's fair to say that we're all feeling a little exhausted after 2 years of going through the pandemic and going in and out of isolation. Maybe you still feel a little bit alone. Also, it may very well be that everything's kind of fine, it's okay, but you're feeling like your relationship with God is maybe a little stagnant or dry. Maybe you're craving some kind of spiritual connection that seems to be missing right now. We might call this spiritual hunger. Like physical hunger, we can feel that spiritual hunger in our mind, our body, our soul, our spirit. There may be sadness, or just a lack of energy, and at the extreme, despair and loneliness and hopelessness. Something important is missing. We hunger for human connection, and we thirst for a glimpse of compassion and friendship. As I mentioned, the theme of our annual conference this year was ending spiritual and physical hunger. Ever since I heard the announcement of that theme, I've been thinking about it and praying about it. And something didn't sit quite right with me, to be perfectly honest, and with all due respect to those who crafted that particular language. I understand the gist of the message. But I really thought about, do we really want to end it? And I ask that question because being hungry and being thirsty are part of being human. God created us with the capacity to experience hunger and thirst. That's why we feel it in our bodies, our minds, our spirits. Babies cry out when they're hungry, when they're thirsty, when they want to be held. And sometimes, so do we. Hunger and thirst are God-given gifts given to humans and other creatures. They let us know that we are in need. They make us curious. They make us go beyond our comfort zones to be nourished. Hunger and thirst are signals that we need to do something in order to survive or thrive. In my family, my kids joke about how hungry somebody must have been in order to see a lobster or a sea urchin and say, I think I'll try to eat that. My own spiritual hunger and thirst brought me to this church when my mother died. This is a place where I have been fed, both physically and spiritually, for more than 30 years. But I craved more. With each meal I had, each time my cup was filled with a beautiful sermon, or an amazing Bible study, or a piece of music from the choir, I wanted more, and that's why I kept coming back. I ended up in seminary at this age because I was still hungry and thirsty for more. I want to know more about God. I want to know more about spirituality. I want to know more about myself and how to serve. And I anticipate being hungry and thirsty for the rest of my life, until that time when I hope I will be seated at God's heavenly banquet. So against this background, that's why I argue that we do not want to end spiritual and physical hunger. We need those alerts. We don't want to end it or numb it. We want to recognize these basic needs in ourselves and in others, and learn how to satiate them on a daily basis in a healthy, compassionate, and respectful way. We have to be consistent, and it has to be sustainable, for we all will be hungry and thirsty again tomorrow. So instead of jumping ahead to ending it, let's go back to the beginning. Let us ask God with humility for guidance in recognizing our own hunger, our own thirst, which brings us back to those three questions. What am I hungry for today? What do I thirst for today? Who around me is in need? Jesus recognized that we need help. We need help in activating our five senses, and we need help in activating our sense. That's what today's scripture illustrates in part. The question posed to Jesus is, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and didn't take care of you? When was that? And Jesus replies, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And maybe the listeners said, like, say that one more time. In these words, Jesus is inviting the disciples and other listeners and all of us here today in 2022 to see the sacred in all persons, and to treat them as if they were Jesus. How we would treat Jesus if Jesus walked through those doors, or was at the side of the road asking for something to eat. This is a reminder to us all that all persons are created in the image of God and of sacred worth, and that we are all connected to one another. While biblical scholars may differ in their interpretation of who the least of these are, many suggest a very broad interpretation. This is consistent with and complements the greatest commandments to love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and with all your mind, and to love your neighbor as yourself, which also appears in the Gospel of Matthew. Again, Jesus is inviting us to see the sacred in all persons, and that includes ourselves. And I make a point of this because we so often don't treat ourselves well with love, compassion, and forgiveness, especially when we are consumed by helping others. What was said in Jesus' day still holds true now. As our friend Stan Shimotsu addressed in his June 14th sermon on the Good Samaritan, we must ask ourselves repeatedly, who is my neighbor? And what am I to do when I encounter a neighbor in need? Do I just look the other way and pretend not to see? Do I make an excuse for ignoring my neighbors and say, you know what? Not my problem. Or do I pause for a moment and truly see him or her or them and discern how I might offer a little kindness or compassion? And how much do I do? Just enough to make myself feel better? Or do I really take into account the needs of this person? One example of seeing and responding with passion and compassion that I've discovered lately in watching a documentary called We Feed the People is the work of Chef Jose Andres and the World Central Kitchen. It's the organization that grew from his call to feed people in distressed communities using his own gifts, love of cooking, his power, his privilege, his resources, and his vast network of connections. In the chef's words, which I couldn't say any better, he tells us that it all began in 2010 after a huge earthquake devastated Haiti. Cooking alongside displaced Haitians in a camp, I found myself getting schooled in how to cook black beans the way they wanted, mashed and sieved into a creamy sauce. You see, says the chef, food relief is not just a meal that keeps hunger away. It's a plate of hope. It tells you in your darkest hour that someone somewhere cares about you. Spiritual and physical hunger being addressed. The chef continues, this is the real meaning of comfort food. It's why we make the effort to cook in a crisis. We don't just deliver raw ingredients and expect people to fend for themselves. And we don't just dump free food into a disaster zone. We source and hire locally, wherever we can, to jumpstart the economy through food. After a disaster, Chef Andres observes, food is the fastest way to rebuild our sense of community. We put people back to work preparing it, and we can put lives back together by fighting hunger. Cooking and eating together is what makes us human. Chef Andres and the World Central Kitchen were one of the first on the ground to feed families in Puerto Rico after Hurricane Maria. They were doing this while our own federal government was fumbling around trying to figure out what to do, and while our own president was tossing paper towels out to people who were starving. The World Central Kitchen also served in brush fire ravaged Australia, in American towns that had been flooded or destroyed in tornadoes. Their teams, on this very day, at this very moment, are serving and feeding people in the Ukrainian war zones and in the rubble left in the aftermath of the earthquake in Afghanistan. The World Kitchen also imagined how shuttered restaurants during the pandemic could engage and reemploy their restaurant workers to feed frontline healthcare workers and other essential workers during the pandemic. So for me, this is what it means to see, to open your eyes and see physical and spiritual hunger and respond with compassion and respect. Not just see, oh, there's a hungry person, but to envision a better way in collaboration with those who are being fed and nourished in body, mind, and spirit. It's not to impose my privileged assumption of what you need, but it is to seek to understand with humility, compassion, and grace how best to meet those needs. It is to prepare those beans in a way that the Haitians love to eat them, the way that brings comfort, love, and hope, and not the way I think you ought to eat them. Locally here in our own church, this is what the West LA Cafe Aloha Ministry to Seniors does. It prepares a culturally savory, delicious bento lunch, and it is hand-delivered, person to person, providing not just physical nourishment, but spiritual nourishment through that human contact and that little bit of conversation. It's comfort food. It's hope on a plate. This too is what is done at the 580 Cafe Campus Ministry at UCLA, providing food for the stomach and food for the soul. As we continue in this sermon series, I invite you to engage more with this scripture and to continue day after day to ask yourselves those questions. What do I hunger for this day? What do I thirst for today? Who around me is in need? And I'm going to close with this final story because it's something that just happened to me last week. But it really helped me open my eyes. And given the timing, I thought it was something I ought to share with you. So a few months ago, as I was going out to my car parked at the curb in front of my house, on my way to church, because that's kind of one of the only places that I would go to record for a worship service, I saw a beat-up old van that was parked askew in the intersection right by my house. And as I was getting into my car, a grizzled old man emerged and waved at me and said, "Could you help me get a tow truck?" And I knew I was running late, but so many thoughts were racing in my head. I was a seminary student studying about ministry and serving others. I'm a member of this church. What is God inviting me to do in this moment? Drop everything and help him? Or to go on my way? If he sees me leave, am I leaving my home vulnerable because he knows nobody's home? I confess here that I was afraid of him, afraid of what he might do. And it doesn't help that I love to watch shows like Dateline and all those true crime mysteries that put all those ideas of worst case scenarios in my head. I told him with some sincerity that I would be right back and would help him then. But I sincerely also hoped that he would be gone by the time I got back, even as I prayed for him on my way to church. When I returned, the van was still there, although it had been moved to the curb in the red zone in front of my house. I don't know how it got there, but I left a list of towing services and AAA and told him I would be happy to help him, and I put that note on the windshield. And a few days went by, the note disappeared, but I never saw the man again. One day the van just disappeared. I had called the city to ask for guidance about what to do. I wasn't ready to have his car towed away or impounded because I knew how expensive that would be for him. But when I woke up and saw that the van was gone, I felt relieved. I confess that too. So flash forward to last week. I was running around getting ready for Reverend Jeri and Reverend Janet's retirement service, and I was stuck in a traffic jam in the grocery store parking lot. Cars waiting to turn onto Sepulveda. And as I was sitting there, an elderly man approached my car and I had just bought a big bag of fresh bagels, so I reached in and got one of the bagels out, grabbed a few dollars out of my glove compartment, and was ready to hand those to him. And as I rolled down my window, he said, "Hey, I remember you. You're the one who helped me when my car broke down in front of your house. Thank you." And as I handed him the bagel and change, he said, "And thank you again." And right then the cars started moving. I was stunned. I was in my car, I had my mask on. We had only had one encounter, yet this man recognized me. But you know what? I didn't recognize him. I had only seen him in that one time in front of my house as a faceless person to be afraid of, to be concerned about. I did a kind gesture, but was it enough? So on that day in the parking lot, by remembering me, God gave me the chance to see the face of Jesus. Amen. Let us pray. God of love, mercy, and grace, who created all beings as sacred and precious in your view, you are the God who blesses us with the gifts of hunger, thirst, empathy, and compassion, and the will to open our eyes, ears, mouths, hands, and hearts to recognize and respond to the needs in this world. Yet, we struggle to live into that potential. Forgive us, God, for closing ourselves off to these needs, looking the other way, and failing to see the face of Jesus in ourselves and our neighbors. We trust that you know we can do better and will be our vision. Thank you, God, for your love and forgiveness that will transform our stumbles into forward motion, where we may serve with Christ-like agility and grace. This day and always, we pray together that you will open our eyes, that we may see all of your children as neighbors and not as others. Open our ears so that we may hear the cries of an empty stomach or a broken soul. And open our hearts so that no one is without spiritual and physical nourishment. We pray that you show us how to recognize our own hunger and thirst and bring awareness of the arrogance and fear that impedes our ability to serve those in need and distracts us from the urgency in our midst. Reveal to us where faith, hope, and love may feed and heal and ignite our imaginations as we seek to serve our neighbors in ways that respect them. We pray for those in our congregation and community and world who are physically and spiritually hungry and thirsty. And we ask for your blessing upon those who are your nourishing servers of food, drink, and love. We pray that you will provide each and every one of us our daily bread and quench our thirst with your luscious living water whenever we hunger or thirst. And so, God of mercy and possibility, open our hearts that we may eat, pray, and love as your people in beloved community, growing more Christ-like together. Amen.
Continuing in prayer, now hear us as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Open your eyes and see the needs of others, and open your ears and hear the cries of the hungry. Open your hearts and respond with compassion for all of God's people. Love this world as God has loved you, and care tenderly for all of creation. Go and faithfully serve in the name of Jesus Christ, and may the grace of Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion with the Holy Spirit be with you today and always. Amen.